In the previous video, we actually got to the stage of adding a button to the screen. But in this video, what we want to do is actually get it so that when we tap something, when we click on the button, it actually updates this text and changes the Hello World to something else. So let's get into how to go about doing that. So we're going to go back to our code, to Android Studio. So again, we've talked about the concepts of buttons and so forth, and we also talked about how there's an interrelationship between the text view and also the design view. So you can sort of see there's differences, but they're actually the same in the sense that you make a change in one place, it's automatically reflected in the other place. Important concept to understand. So let's make a bit more space here, like so. Now, actually, what I normally do is a lot of the time I will go into text view, but sometimes I'll also go into design view. It really depends what you're used to doing. But what we want to do now is we want to add some code. So at the moment, when you're actually designing your layout, what you're doing is you're setting up, you're showing the buttons and so forth. So the actual layout and how your application is going to look like is done here. But in terms of the actual, you know, what's going to happen when we do something, when a button is clicked or something's updated on the screen, we do that back in our Java code. So even though there is a relationship between the two, and in this video I'm going to hopefully give you a bit of better understanding of how they actually interrelate, it's important to understand that this view is where we're actually talking about how things look, but the code is how things actually, you know, what functionality happens, what processes happen when a particular button is clicked, and those types of things. So for the next bit to start, what we need to do is change some of our code. We need to go back to our main activity. And if you recall, we had this main activity class that I talked about in a previous video. This was the one that was created automatically by the wizard. So it's now time to add a little bit of extra code here. So what we need to do firstly is we need a way for this code to be able to talk to our layout file, our activity underscore main, which of course was the one that we were just editing a minute ago when we could see it sort of showing up on the screen. It turns out there is a way of doing that. Firstly, this command here is the command that links the Java code to the activity, to the type of layout that we're using or the actual layout we're using. But we also need a way to be able to access these elements, so the elements that are actually in or on the XML file. So in other words, we want to be able to target to use the My button to be able to reference that and even to be able to reference this field. So how do we go about doing that? Well, that's using the concept of IDs. And what's going to be important is to understand the ID. And we can go down and have a look. The ID, you notice the ID, we've called this one button. That was the default name. And you can change that and call that literally anything else that you want. So you can just click on an element and you can have a look over here and it will tell you what the actual name is. And likewise, you can click on text view instead if you want. And you notice that this is the bit of code that relates to that. So the part after the slash is the name that you would also use to refer to. You'll see that shortly in the code. And notice how each of these views, and remembering that each part of a layout is called a view, has got its own name, which you're actually free to change. So going back to our code, firstly what we need to do is, in programming terms, we need to allocate a button and a text view so that we can start getting access to those. So we can start, you know, adding something to them. So to do that, right below where it's got public cast main activity, I'm going to type private button with a capital B. And notice as you're typing, Android Studio is telling you all the time, is this what you mean? And as you type more letters, it removes options. So if I start up with a B, I've got a pile of options, but as I start typing, it's breaking down the options into, if that's the one you want, you can just press enter and it will actually add the rest for you automatically. So that's the case, that's what we want. We're going to call it our button. So that line, the private, don't worry about that. We'll talk about that in a future video. But the way that Java works is there's two parts. There's the type and then a name that we're assigning to it. So this name here, our button, could literally have been anything. I've called it our button. And button is telling Java that, okay, we're going to be dealing with a button. So moving on, I'm going to do the same thing. So that's one for a button. And if we have a look at the next one, it's private text view. It's important to type it in uppercase, because if you type it in lowercase, you'll actually get a red error. So if you see a red error, normally that's a typo and you need to just check your typing to make sure you have typed it in the correct case. It's a common source of errors. In this case, text view in uppercase. And did you also notice quickly, you saw the screen update here. And what actually happened was, Android Studio automatically added that for us quickly. And that's because of a setting that we set up previously in the setup video for Android Studio. We got it to actually go ahead and automatically add these lines as it needs to when we're creating these variables, or anytime it needs to when we're creating code. So what Android Studio will do is add that if it's unambiguous. And in terms of what the import line is, we will talk about that more in future videos, but the bottom line is that's just a reference that Android Studio knows and needs to know in order to be able to use it. But the point I'm making here is it's added that for us automatically, and it did the same to button on the previous line as well. And likewise, if I take those out and delete them, they're now highlighted in grey, and grey means they're not being used. You can actually just leave your mouse over the top of it, and it'll actually tell you it's an unused import statement. So I'll paste those back in, and they should go back to black, which they have. And we'll call this next one, let's just call it our message. So what we've done is we've assigned a slot, like a memory location, for these buttons. And we've said that we've created a variable, so a type, to actually store our information. But what we haven't done is link them. So we need some way to link these references here, these variables that we've created, to the actual text view, which is this item here, and the actual button here. So we need to actually link those two together. So the way we do that, or where we do that, is in the onCreate method, which is this part of the code here. And we need to do that on the line after this setContentView. And the reason we're doing it on the line after is that is the actual line that actually links the code to our layout, to our activity underscore main. So if we tried to do it beforehand, the link wouldn't have been established and we'll get an error. So next, what we need to do is we need to actually do that association, which I've mentioned. And the way to do that is we type in our variable. So our button equals, and I'm going to type in this, and we'll come back to what's in brackets in a minute. But we type it in brackets just like that, button. And then we actually type in something called find view by ID. Now notice as I'm typing, Android Studio has come up automatically. So that's the one I want. So I'm going to press enter. And what find view by ID does, it actually is looking to link what is in that layout back to our Java code. So we need to actually type in that ID. And if you remember the ID, again, we'll go back to that again and have a look. That's this ID. So if I click on the button, for argument's sake, scroll down and have a look, that's this ID here. So this is a unique ID. You can't duplicate these. The IDs need to be unique for every view item that's actually on your layout. So if you've got 100 elements, you need to have 100 different names, and they all need to be something different. So in this case, if we go back, remembering that the actual button, our ID's name is called button. So we go back to our code. We use this find view by ID, and we link it by actually typing capital R dot ID in lowercase dot. You know, notice what's come up automatically. We've got action underscore settings, button, text view, and some other ones that aren't applicable. But the two important ones are button and text view, because of course they relate exactly to what's in that layout file. And by doing that, this command like so, and ending it with a semicolon, what we've done is we've then provided that link. So we've linked the button that's in the layout file to our variable in our Java code, and consequently, because they're linked, we can start performing actions to them. And let's do the same thing now for our text, for our text view, which was our message. So it's our message equals text view, find view by ID. And you can probably guess this, r.id.textview, like so. Now you might be wondering what this is. So we can actually take that out. If we take that out, we get an error. And the reason is, if you have a look at it, it actually will make sense. It says incompatible types required android.widget.button, but found android.view.view with a capital V. Now remember that I said all items on a layout are views, and that actually is the case here. So what's happening is when we use the find view by ID, when we type that in, that is applicable to any type of button. Sorry, any type of view, I should say, which can be a button, could be a text view, like a field to enter information in. It could be a progress bar. It could be any number of things. So what we need to do, by putting it in the brackets like we've done, we're being specific. We're saying we want you to treat this button as a button, because that's what it is. And that then makes this variable button, it makes sense to that button, and it knows that, oh, okay, you're talking about a button. So that's why we're putting that in brackets. And again, as we go through the course, this will start making more sense. So at the moment, what we've done with this onCreate, in this onCreate, and this is called a method, what we've done is we've provided that association. So we've now linked them. But what we haven't done at the moment is we haven't actually performed any actions. So that's the next step, is to start thinking about performing some actions. So what we want to do, if we go back to our emulator, you recall that there was a button there that we could click, and we could click on settings. And if we go back to our code, that equated to this method here. So we've got a special method that is automatically added for us for menu options that are in or on the form. But when we want to perform functionality on other fields, we normally have to add some mechanism ourselves. We need to add a little bit of code so that there's a mechanism for Android to call that function back to us, to, in other words, to tell us that something's happened for that button. Because at the moment, this, even though we've linked them both together, if we run this, we'll find that it actually won't do anything still. And I'll just run it to show you. And we'll just go back over. Oops, I'll go back and select that first. Click on OK and go back to emulator and wait till that updates. You should see that update like so. If we run it, even though we've provided a link to them, we haven't actually told it to do anything. So as far as the Android operating system is concerned, it's aware that there's a button on the form. It knows that there's been a click made, but we still haven't linked those two things together. And that's what we want to do next. We want to actually add that link so that we can actually get it to do something. So to do that, I'm just going to clear off this. And what we need to do is now add that. So the way to do that, and there is a variety of ways of doing this. I'm going to show you one way, but actually in the next application, I'm going to show you a simplified version of it. But this is just one way to do it anyway. So we're going to add what's called a click listener. What that means is it's really as it sounds. It's some code that is going to listen and wait for something to happen. And when that happens, it's going to perform some action. So what we need to do is create a variable. We're going to call it on click listener. Now, I wanted to show you also, when you type in something that's not unambiguous, like in the case of button and text view, when they were typed, Android Studio knew that there was only one version of each of those, so it didn't have to ask a question. In this case, what Android Studio is saying is there's multiple versions here. Which one do you want? So what we need to do, and it gives you the little shortcut there on the, to the right. In my case, it means on a Mac, it's actually Option and Enter. So if I press Option Enter now, I believe it's Alt-Enter on a Mac, but in any event, when you're typing this in on a Windows machine, you'll see that the relevant option will show for your whatever operating system you're running. But I'm going to press Option-Enter. Now, as I do that, I've got two options. And this will happen anytime, as I mentioned, when there's more than one option, Android Studio will ask which one do you want. In our case, we want the Android.view, this one down the bottom, view.onclicklisten. So I'm just going to click on that. And again, you notice at the top something happened, and if you scroll up and have a look, the view has been added automatically, as you can see there. So what we need to do is then type, well, there's two ways of doing it. We could then go back and actually type it like that if we wanted to. And just allow it to add the view dot automatically, because I think view was actually there before. But we could actually add it as a separate element. But in this case, we're going to just leave it as it is, because that's fine. I'm going to type our on-click listener equals space new. Now, I start typing view automatically. You can see right at the top here, there's an option, and it looks a little bit different to the other ones. There's these little brackets, which are called braces. And if I just select that first option or press Alt-Enter, just press Enter there with that menu option selected, you'll see what happens. You can see automatically the Android added all that code. I just pressed Enter literally, and it added that code for us. So whenever you see it, something like that, make sure you press Enter, because it saves you having to type it. Now, you could have typed all this in automatically, but why not get Android Studio to do a lot of it for you? So we'll be talking more about what this means, but essentially what we've done is we've added a mechanism for Android to be able to call back and tell us that in fact that button was clicked. So that's what this is, sort of like some skeleton code for that to happen. So this is the mechanism now for Android to come back and actually tell us. So now what we want to do is, what do we want to happen when that button has actually been ticked, has been pressed? Well, what we want to do in this case is we want to display that message. We want that message on the screen that currently says hello world to show something else. So to do that, we're going to put our message dot set text. The button got tapped. That's it. So that one line is going to change the message, the actual text that's showing for hello world, and it should change it to the button got tapped. So that's literally all we're going to do there. And the other thing we need to do here is, and you can see IntelliJ is always trying to help us, saying, oh, hang on a minute, you've missed something there. If you hover over it, you can see it says semicolon expected. So we need to put a semicolon, which you do for all Java code when you've finished a line to close it off. So what we've done at the moment is we've actually added the skeleton code so that Android Studio knows what to do when something happens. And we've also told it what to do when it does happen. But the last thing we actually need to do is we need to link this together. So in other words, what we need to do is we need to tell our button, we need to actually get it to be associated with this Our OnClick listener. And by doing that, it can then execute that code and we can get Android to start talking. And just to confirm that, if we go back and try and run this now, go back to our emulator. So when we go to run it, still nothing's happening. This message isn't being updated. And that's because we've done everything but link it. What we've done is we've set up this space, this skeleton code, and some code that's actually going to update something. But the last thing we need to do is actually tell the button that we've defined, to use this bit of code. And the way we do that is we type our button dot set on click listener. And notice how I typed that in the right case. And if I type, and now if I select our OnClick listener, and I've just typed in the first couple of letters, and you notice that Android Studio is helpfully telling us, oh, do you mean this? So that's the one we want. And that's actually the command. So what we've done now is we've actually associated that. And so what should happen now is if we run this, we should actually get that message being updated on the screen. So let's accept that. Oops, did I click that? I don't think I clicked that. There we go. Go back to emulator. Wait till it updates. So now when we click my button, success, the button got tapped. And of course, subsequent times when we're tapping it, it's just redisplaying that message, so we're not seeing it getting updated. But the bottom line is we've now got a very basic application working, and it's actually shown you how you can actually get something to happen on screen. So what we're going to do now, I'm going to end this video here because it's getting a little bit long, but in the next video we're going to enhance this, and we're actually going to store how many times the button's got tapped and show that on the screen. So I'll see you in that next video.